Greetings, everyone. I cannot start to tell you what a difference this feels to be standing on a stage. I even get to now wear a tie. I know that's not normal because most of us have spent about 7 months not wearing ties. And therefore, I have looked forward to this moment of actually being able to be here. Now, the next 29 minutes, we are going to cover three things in two phases. We'll first look at the first phase of what is really happening with digitalization, starting, in fact, with a somewhat provocative question, which is, did digital die? And the second phase has two components to it, which is, in order to accelerate digital, we have to focus on something which has nothing to do with technology, really not so much to do with business, but has more to do with two fundamental things of acceleration, namely, what is it that we as individuals need from a perspective of leadership skills or competencies? And how do we really have to, secondly, look at what is the governance of artificial intelligence in a digital world? Now, before we start, let's at least establish a few axiomatic elements of this. First being, the world is being eaten by software. A famous, now long-term quote from Marc Andreessen, but still very true. Software is what the world is about. The second thing is, every company in the world is now a company that acts as a software company. Software is the fundamental element of business. And the third part of this is the data, and more specifically, the algorithms that define the decisions that we have to take is at the core of everything we do in what is now this next phase of digitalization. Now first, let's start by establishing what I believe are some fundamental facts. And what better to borrow this from the venerable organization Gartner? Where are we with digital? And where specifically are we today with artificial intelligence? There's no doubt that organizations are now starting to increase the actual usage of intelligent algorithms within their organization. We can see that they not only are deploying the algorithms, but they're increasing the number of algorithms deployed, hence therefore the breadth in terms of complexity of artificial intelligence, but they're also changing the depth at which it is deployed within the organization, now touching all aspects of what today is the digitalization of the organization. But what is it really that are the phases that we will go through? Let me first start by debunking something I said in the beginning. No, digital did not die. But our first wave, first phase, first generation, you may choose whatever word you want, was a phase that ended in the beginning of 2020. And it did end with many organizations asking themselves, can I really scale what I have done elegantly at the project level to something that defines my organization? Then, of course, the horrible crisis of COVID hit us, which then caused a skew of digitalization. Many people have said that actually this was an acceleration of digitalization, and that may be true, but it is not necessarily a full implementation of what was your strategy. It was a move to agile strategy, but it also skewed our focus. And that skewed focus cannot last forever. In fact, we are probably into the next phase now, which is a phase of cost optimization of digitalization. And therefore, frankly, this is what leads to the acceleration and usage of artificial intelligence, in particular, as we will see a little later, in terms of the usage of automation across the organization, and not just dumb automation, but automation that is intelligent in its implementation. The last phase is that of changing what we view as digitalization going forward. And why we will not spend a long time on this, I believe it is important for us to start to imagine. Imagine what things will be 15 years out using known technologies. And I would encourage you to at least include four of these. First, what happens when cloud is pervasive? Not just used where feasible, but pervasive, all the way to the edge of the organization. Secondly, what happens when artificial intelligence is pervasive to the edge of the organization? That we are not just talking about centrally deploying a number of different algorithmic models and machine learning environments, but really that this is what defines your compute architecture, your digital architecture as it stands. And then, of course, we have to think about some of the newer technologies that are emerging now that we know of. What happens when communication technologies accelerate their speeds, such as with 5G or next generation environments, as well as fourth, what happens when we change the paradigm of compute? While that doesn't happen immediately, we know it is already happening across the globe, certainly around here in Europe, when you see the auto manufacturers and the pharmaceutical companies, and even some of the banks, starting to tactically and maybe pointed from a strategic perspective, deploying different compute architectures such as that of quantum computing. What happens? Imagine that world. Imagine that world. And that world will then include three things that is part of what spurs the need to really think about leadership skills and about artificial intelligence from a governance perspective. First is, it is a world governed by autonomous products, the famous GE definition of digital twins. Secondly, it is a world that is governed by automated processes. In essence, a replica of your organization, or perhaps even the definition of your organization as being digital and fully digital. And then third, but not least, what happens with the human-machine interaction? What is digital engagement 15 years from now? Now, you could spend a little time thinking about this, and we will all arrive at a lot of fascinating technical issues about business model issues, about how we would actually run an organization. But the main thing we really do need to think about is, how does that organization change how you lead? How you as a manager, as a leader, act in the world that we are moving into? A fact often forgotten in what we saw as the first wave of digitalization, because most of the responsibility relied on the CIO, the chief digital officer, the chief data officer, people with a technical, and in some instances, very strong business knowledge, but only part of what defines the organization's leadership team and what the organization really is. So this world is a world of digital processes, digital products, and digital citizens. Now, if we move back into perhaps the more near present, what we really need to see as a ramification of this is one significant trend of several that are starting to impact how our organization is defined. And that is the deployment of automation, not just our traditional, perhaps somewhat dumb automation in terms of assisted robotic process automation, but more specifically what we see at the very top, which is an intelligent robotic process automation that is having significant impacts on organizations across the globe. And why is just this point particularly important to make? For one particular reason is it is being driven by the ability to optimize cost. And perhaps also through that, optimize quality and experience that we can give, not just internally in the organization, but also externally. And this wave is starting to have tremendous impact, first on service organizations, for example, in the financial services sector, but will equally run its course throughout businesses. And that impacts, therefore, what we need to look at in many organizations from a perspective of how does that change process governance? How does it change management? Because these aspects sit at the top of that change. Inside this overly simplistic model sits the internal trends of technology change, both through robotic process automation, the extension and acceleration and broadening of artificial intelligence, and the change that we are now seeing in terms of deployment of applications in the cloud to therefore accelerate our capability of becoming an agile organization. So this experiment of thought, an experiment of imagination, is important, and it is important for a particular reason. And that reason is that we have to ask ourselves, as human beings, what is digital engagement? And often, we regard digital engagement as something that happens in the intersection between us and the screen. But imagine for a period that you are a manager in 2035, in which your responsibility, your area of responsibility, includes a number of human beings, and then a number of intelligent algorithms and machine learning environments, and that defines your area of responsibility. You therefore need to now start to consider, what does the world look like when I have to do a performance review for a bot? What does the world look like when I talk about cultural change, including not just human beings, but also bots, also intelligent algorithms? And that then starts to pose a number of, in my mind, incredibly fascinating questions around how we define leadership. Now, first, when I say leadership, what I mean by that is everyone that manages in an organization. Every one of us have a series of particular leadership skills that define not just who we are, but also the responsibilities that we have. Secondly, we do know that in many organizations, a strong leadership team and a strong middle management team is the difference between either financial or service, if you're a public level organization, service level excellence. So financial excellence and performance vis-a-vis organizations that have average or mediocre leadership environments. And so in this next phase of digitalization, the phase that comes after what we have experienced and still are experiencing with COVID, that has skewed us over towards certain aspects of digitalization, and a phase of cost optimization that will look at perhaps subtracting some of the projects we have been working on, we now need to start to consider, what is it really that we need to differentiate ourselves? And I believe the starting point has to be leadership, has to be an understanding of how this changes the way we govern. Equally, there are other aspects of this. Culture is important. How do we switch the culture? It is also a question of how we manage from a financial perspective. Those will reserve for some time later. Let's focus at those two, leadership and how leadership defines things, and equally then also governance. Let me first talk about what it is that happens in an organization as we start to increase the level of digitalization of which artificial intelligence is at the heart of what we do. All of us as leaders, and I'm not just talking about individuals in the technology sector, I am talking about all leaders, can look at the left-hand side of the chart and say, this possibly describes me. You all do budgeting at some level. You are all responsible for management of people, leadership of people. You are responsible or part of the process of strategy and planning. You do change management. Certainly, it is something that we have excelled at over the course of the last 7 months. We do project management. And then we have a series of functionally specific skills. Now, what's functionally specific skills? Well, if you're in marketing, you have a set of functional specific skills in marketing. If you are in finance, you have a functional set of specific skills there that make you excellent for that job. Now think about this. All of you have gone through an education process. It could be through university or business schools. It could equally also be an education process in life. During that education process, how much did you learn about managing an environment that was a mixture of technology and people? We didn't. How much did you learn about how to be agile in mindset and execute in a way that isn't a traditional way of executing from a process perspective or project perspective? Now, I am sure there are somebody out there that will say, I'm really good at the new world. And if you are, I believe that is fantastic. You have an enormous responsibility now because you have to then train 99% of other people in your organization. Because when we look at what happens with a digital shift in the world we are moving into, it changes our classical leadership skills. Budgeting isn't just an annual process anymore. 2020 has definitely taught us that. The budget you started thinking you had when you went through the budgeting process through the end of last year is for sure not the budget you have today. And so we've learned that we change in an agile fashion, and we equally know that there are many things we do from a budgeting perspective that, frankly, you don't need to do because we can have technology execute that, which means budgeting is a combination of our intuition skills, our skills as human beings, and that of artificial intelligence. The same thing is true with people management. Why would we manage people without acknowledging that there are many things that could be done? For example, a significant amount of what you do from a performance management perspective could be something that you talk to people about and then you actually execute them through a bot that then combines it into part of the performance review that you do with people. And obviously that performance review is not an annual process anymore. It is a process that is a continuous process. Now, I could go through all of these. Clearly, obviously, we all have to think through what the bottom one does in terms of how it impacts the world that we are in, because our functional skills change. Our functional skills and the way we act from a functional perspective, whether you're in marketing, in finance, in HR, in a business unit and therefore acting, has to change because artificial intelligence and the usage of technology shifts the way we define functional skills. So this is the first thing from a leadership skill perspective that we need to do. The second thing that we need to understand is, what do we need to do that is new? And first, let's just make sure that we clearly understand what the responsibility of some of the key leaders are in the organization. So the CEO now has to be responsible not just for the digitalization and the strategy of the organization, and in particular the execution of the strategy, but also how do we actually define governance for our organization going forward, because the CEO is responsible to the board of the organization that ultimately has the responsibility for things like strategy and how governance is executed. There are other individuals that we need to include. Obviously, the chief legal counsel needs to think about, how does this change? What is legal today? How does it impact us? We've had a minute little taste of it across Europe as we've implemented GDPR, but trust me, that is a minute little change and taste of what is coming as we move forward, such as we could see what the European Union is implementing around artificial intelligence. The CFO is responsible for risk and obviously cost. The CHRO, so this is the human resource officer, has to be thinking about how does it change the definition of culture, how does it change the definition of employee policies in an organization as we execute things. And yes, then there are individuals that we have associated in wave one with the shift, chief digital officers, CIOs, chief data officers, that here are responsible for the data elements of the change. All of these people have to decide what to do. And one thing they all need to be focused on is how do they develop themselves and how do they develop the organization with a series of new leadership skills. Call these traits, competencies, or leadership skills. I believe these seven define new things that every leader, and you may be sitting there from a technology perspective and say, I know technology, but I would encourage everyone in the organization to understand that the leadership using technology is not reserved to one part of the organization, it is a shared responsibility. And so I've divided these seven leadership skills up into two groups, the hard skills, which are the darker ones, and then softer skills, which are not necessarily new, but are of increased importance to everyone here, because these you were not taught in business school or at university, because they didn't exist when the majority of us went through business school or university. And so this is a multi-year change process, and if we do not focus on this, 3 years from now, we will again ask the question, did digital die? So, a little greater depth in terms of what they are. First, the four hard ones, they should be relatively obvious, but it is about understanding how technology can change what you do as a leader, as a manager. It is about understanding how we implement an agile, a flexible, a dynamic culture in an organization. It is about understanding what we have heard about this morning as to how does data science impact what it is we do as leaders? And last but not least, how do you manage in a world that is defined by where your business responsibility includes a series of artificial and machine learning-based environments? As I said, imagine the day you have to provide a performance review of a bot, because that bot is the totality of what you do or what somebody else does. And then the softer ones, we are entering a world, which is why I asked you to imagine what it would be. We are entering a world in which we need to hone in on a skill set that has been talked about for some years, which is how do we tell stories? How do we actually execute things in a world where we can't say it looks like this? Because this doesn't exist. You're the first that will do it. And remember, the combinations of technology are infinite. So therefore, this may be only applicable to what you do. Or then how do we do management of innovation, not as a centralized activity, but as a leadership capability? And last but not least, how do you create ideation? How does ideas happen in your organization? And we could spend lots of time on how you get there, but I just want to note, these seven leadership skills, I personally believe, will fundamentally shift the organization because it unfreezes the organization's broad management team from the world that they have been in the first wave of digitalization. Then let's switch to governance. First, lots of people talk about governance, and there are many definitions. In fact, the word governance has appeared in business language since about the 1980s, and it means different things from an English language perspective. When I talk about it, I would say that it has to at least include things like explainability of what we do, transparency of what we do, something about the accountability, and last but not least, about ethics. Now, you may view this as a small side area that isn't important. If you believe artificial intelligence is the heart of digitalization, wouldn't it be a good idea to start to think about this from a governance perspective? And so I'll go through three charts that talk a little bit about what this would really mean for you as an organization. We'll do it relatively rapidly. So the first thing would be think about the following situations as you now digitalize your organization using the data as the heart of what you do. First question to ask yourself, does your employees or customers need to know when they encounter an intelligent software environment that are making decisions that in the past were taken by human beings? Do they have a right to know? Going even further, do they need to be notified when a decision has been taken? So they can be told it's happening, but they don't know exactly where in the process. Should they be notified of when it is happening? Should they be able to review the decision? Meaning, if we lack trust in digital, and more so lack trust in artificial intelligence, should they review it? Should they be able to opt out of the decision? Your customers, your suppliers, your employees might decide, I don't feel comfortable with this. Every one of your environments today contain bias. You may think not. Every data environment contains bias because it is a definition of what you have defined as the environment. It doesn't necessarily define what your future employees will be, what your suppliers will be, and who your prospects will be in the future. So, do we need to be notified of bias? Gender bias, racial bias, age bias exists in all systems today. And then last but not least, is there a legal aspect to this in which there is a remedy for use? As we now embark on digitalization, this is the first thing that we need to start to think about. I believe that results in the second thing, which is we do need to then ultimately start to think about, shouldn't we develop a charter for what is artificial intelligence and therefore the governance of this in our organization? Shouldn't we think about elements of that which would be customers, employees, and suppliers? Should there be a customer charter? Should there be one, in fact, that is public to everyone? Something that your customer can see what you stand for, which should be part of what you stand for from a perspective of where you're going from a digitalization perspective. Should your employees have an idea of how you look at artificial intelligence as it pervades your systems as we embark on this new wave of intelligent automation within existing internal process systems? And last but not least, wouldn't you want your suppliers to be aware of what you're doing? After all, you tell your suppliers about what you stand for, what your ethics are in the world we have come from. Why not tell them what the world is going to be like and what is your view of how artificial intelligence impacts your digitalization process? And then the last thing is, it's fine we put this in place. How are we going to measure this? And measuring it can contain a large number of different metrics or KPIs or objectives. You may call it different things, But we all know that we need to figure that out, because part of a strategic change means being able to measure things. We all know that 2 out of 3 implementations of strategy fail. Every minute, organizations lose, in aggregate, $3 million on failed strategy implementations, of which digital is part of that. So we need to change that, and we need to think about it from a more agile perspective, hence therefore likely involving technology. But metrics such as, how does our data look? Metrics such as, how secure are our environments? The cost and value of artificial intelligence decisions, how does it impact things? What is our status on bias? You can actually measure bias, and so if you want to improve it, you gotta get a benchmark for it. All of these different KPIs should define what it is we do as an organization, and has to be the third pillar of thinking about what the world will be like as artificial intelligence becomes the center of what we do in our digitalization efforts. So, what actions can you take? Not just on artificial intelligence, but on what we've talked about the last 30 minutes. You have to determine the executive responsibilities in this next wave. A significant number of organizations kind of stalled their digital implementation. And part of it was not everybody were involved, and the ones that were involved had old world metrics. So we need to have a different approach to governance, to leadership skills, and that starts with the board and the CEO. We need to think about this from a new charter perspective. How do we develop a new charter? We need to manage and measure and implement a series of KPIs, metrics, or objectives for what the world is going to be like. You're responsible for ensuring that that gets put in place. You have to become more successful in the implementation and execution of digital strategies, which now incorporate artificial intelligence. And then we should use technology for this. We should use technology for the governance of artificial intelligence as part of the digitalization efforts. We should use technology as part of the change in terms of how we execute our digital strategy. Isn't it funny that the majority of organizations are executing what they see as a fundamental, interesting change in what they're doing using technology, except in the actual execution of it? We would be happy, and many of us probably use a spreadsheet for planning digital change. That can't be right. And so think about how you implement this from a perspective of a series of electronic software-based environments that can help you accelerate the change. Communication around what happens in particular with the AI element of digitalization. And then last but not least, one of my main focuses here has been leadership matters. Leadership is now not ready for what we are going to do. And that is no fault of anybody in this room. We do not have the experience. So it is the responsibility of everybody to personally, because nobody's going to give it to you, to personally start to select a series of new capabilities that you want to learn to do better. And at least set yourself the objectives to change what you personally are doing. And secondly, what your leadership team is responsible for changing as we move into this next world of digitalization. May the digital force be with you in whatever you do.